tonight we're going to be talking about prayer. And prayer is so awesome. I just thank God that he give us the boldness that we can go into the throne room boldly and ask for forgiveness. If someone have John 17, can you give me John 17 on your phone and give it to me later? Well, I'll let you know. But an intercessor is one that fights on behalf of other people spiritually or other things. It can be a person, place, or thing. So that's what an intercessor does. But intercession is the activity of us identifying with Christ, because, you know, Christ was the great intercessor, and he still is the great intercessor. And so Christ always praying for people all the time. And that's what he wants us to do. He wants us to always pray for people all the time. And so if you find yourself always just drawn to prayer and drawn to prayer, then you may be called to intercede. And there's a levels of prayer. When you first start praying, you in really level one, you just pray for people and pray for any and everything. But when you get to a level where you just have to be drawn and you find yourself doing this all the time, then you are caught up in intercessory prayer, which is a gift from God. And at one point or another, all of us at one point or another will pray for someone or something. Amen. And so Jesus is the great intercessor, and I like it because he prayed for others. One thing that he did in, when he was hanging on the cross, he interceded for the people. Even though he was going through, what did he say? He said, Father, forgive them because they know not what they do. And then another thing, he prayed for the people when he was raising Lazarus from the dead. He said, Father, I know that you always hear me, but here I am. I'm praying for them that they may believe that you did send me. And so I just love it because he's always praying for us. And praying, you find yourself praying where you don't even think about it at all. Amen. Amen. You find yourself just praying, and you don't even think about it that you're praying. And so John 11, that's a good intercessory prayer. But many times Jesus went away to pray. That's what he did. He went away to pray. Can you pull the camera up some? We see all our people head. Amen. And so anyway, Jesus always went away to pray. His whole life was that of being an intercessor. And so he felt that it was important to intercede while he was here on earth. Because everything that he did, he interceded for someone. When before he healed, he prayed for them. And so what God is telling us, if Jesus felt a need to pray when he was on earth, since we're on earth, shouldn't we feel that same need to pray? And so not all prayer is intercession. Many times we'll find ourselves in petition. We're just asking God for something or to take care of certain needs for us. But true intercession will consist of a couple of things. A person will know that God has divinely pulled them in to intervene for a person. And then another thing, that we're always praying and interceding so we can destroy the works of the devil. And so Ezekiel 22 tells you that God looked for a person to build up the wall and to stand in the gap so that those people would not be destroyed. But he said he couldn't find anybody. Isn't that something? He said he couldn't find anybody to stand in the gap to intercede for these people. And so the first thing having to do with Ezekiel 22 and 30, it said God is the one that gave that divine request for somebody to pray. I love it. He's the one. And why did he give that divine request for someone to pray? Because he saw that the people needed to keep the land from being destroyed, to keep the people from being destroyed. And so that was a specific request from God. And then another aspect of Ezekiel 22 and 30, that whenever God called you to pray, it's his divine intervention. He requests you to pray. And when he requests you to pray, we don't have to worry about it, because guess what? On the inside of you is the ability to destroy the demonic strategies of Satan. And so anything that Satan has set up for you, because he gets angry when we go and pray. He does not want us to pray. And so whatever he has set up for you, God has already given you the strength. He's already given you the ability to handle that thing. And so one thing that you as an intercessor, or you as one that pray, don't ever, ever, ever think that Satan is stupid, because he's not stupid. Because if he was stupid, and if he wasn't anything that we need to think about as far as our spiritual warfare is concerned, then why did Jesus have him in the Bible? He told Peter, he said he seeks to sift you as wheat. And so he seeks to sift you as wheat. He wants to shred you so that you can fall. And so what I'm doing, I'm telling you that this is what he wants to do, because he doesn't want you to go forth in what God called you to do. He seeks to shred you up. You know, like I was thinking about shredded cheese, you know, where I was like, it's a shredded cheese. So anyway, but he have all kind of methodologies. He have all kind of strategies. He have all kind of demiologies. Every single thing, the Bible calls it the wiles of the devil. He has all of those things that he set forth to try to trip us up. And so we can't say that he's stupid. We can't say that he does not know what he's doing. But what? Guess what? He doesn't want you around. You know why? Because God didn't want him around. And so God chose us to be around and to worship him, which Satan was supposed to have been doing. But then he didn't want to worship God. He wanted to be above God. But God said, do not be ignorant of his devices. And so he multiplied his devices. Those imps that are in his organized forces are afraid of him. And that's why they go about and they do all of his bidding. They do everything that he tells them to do. He sends them out. Amen. And so what he does, he has a function that he moves in our lives, waging war to try to get us to think that it is someone else. His main focus is to come against the mind of an intercessor. I always tell intercessors, and you can just look at them and tell, you know, that something is going on with them, because guess where they fight? In the heavenlies. So guess what the demonic forces are? In the heavenlies. And so they always praying, they're always traveling in the heavenlies, and they're fighting. And so the things that they're warding off, the things that they're stopping from occurring, Satan does not want that to happen. And so he waged war against them many, many times. Amen. That's his job. That's what he's called to do in his facet of life. He's called to make us feel like we're losing our mind. And so that's why God always said, let this mind be in you that's also in Christ Jesus. One thing he come against us with is forgiveness. Amen. He come against us with forgiveness. We have problems with casting down those thoughts that come that are from Satan. We have that problem. And we have problem pulling down strongholds. And we have problems with rendering all those things to be captive into the obedience of Christ. That's what he does. And so many intercessors really fight for their mind. They really fight for their mind, because that's the first thing that he goes after, is the mind. Why? Because he does not want what Jesus said. Let this mind be in you that's also in Christ Jesus. And so in Ephesians 6 and 12, he gives us a definition of his kingdom. It's the kingdom of darkness. He tells us we do not wrestle with flesh and blood. That's one of the things that he does, is to have us to wrestle with people, wrestle with things that bleed. But he said we don't wrestle with flesh and blood. And we don't wrestle with the people that's here on earth. But we're fighting against those principalities and those powers and those demonic forces organized in heavenly places. Amen. The rulers, the principalities, the powers the rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. And so what happened, our mind is a high place. And so the enemy comes and he put wickedness in our mind. It says, and I can't remember, it's Ecclesiastic, but it says that wickedness sits, or jealousy sits upon the throne of our heart. And jealousy brings about wickedness. Amen. And so the word wrestling is a Greek word for death. That's what he wants to do. He wants us to fight with one another until somebody get killed, because guess what? Wrestling has a lot to do with death. Death is his Satan, is Satan's end result having to do with us. It goes hand in hand. He's not going to come after us if he's not trying to kill us. He's not going to come after us if he's not trying to kill our spouse or kill someone in our family. Amen. But in Ephesians 6 and 11, inform us that when we go into battle, we got to put on the full armor of God. And when you read Ephesians 6, it tells you exactly what you and I must put on. Amen. And when we put it on, then we are able to stand against the wiles or the methodologies or the ideologies of Satan. Amen. In all the battles that he has against us. Praise God. Hebrews 7 and 25 informs us that we as intercessors live to make those know that Christ paid a price for us. We have our lives here in earth. And why are we here in earth? Because he paid a price for us. And so an intercessor is a mediator. She's a go-between, or he's a go-between. And we are here to let people know that Jesus paid the price for us, that we don't have to stay on Satan's side. And so we are able, he fixed it where you as an intercessor and I as an intercessor, or you as a person that pray, go into the king's room boldly, into the throne room boldly. We have this. We have grace to go into the king's room boldly, into the throne room boldly. And then when we go in there, we can ask for grace. We can ask for forgiveness. And we don't have to be ashamed to go in there. We don't have to have fear of retribution, because he paid the price for us to be able to go into the throne room boldly. And we can ask him whatever it is that we want to ask him. Praise God. And so whenever a person has a prayer request, I like this. Whenever someone pray and they cry out to God, Jesus cried to Jesus, and Jesus looks over to the Father, and he said, Father, do it for them. And the Father and Jesus ministered to Holy Spirit, and Holy Spirit go and get that request done. Amen. But the way Holy Spirit get it done is through someone that he has called to pray. Someone that can reach him, someone that's used to standing in the gap, that can understand his voice, that understand his ways. There's no way in the world that you and I can pray if we don't understand God, we don't understand his ways, we don't understand how to get in touch with him. Amen. Because the Bible says ways are far above finding out. And so what he was saying is that we have to get somewhere and be still. One thing about an intercessor, we have to be still. Can't be moving all over the place. He got to be still so you can know this is God. An intercessor must have a discerning of spirit to know that this is God and this is not God. Amen. And so a lot of times, Holy Spirit begins to minister to someone who is called to pray. But he nudge, he move upon us, he move in our mind, and he's trying to get us to move out and pray. He's nudging us. He's knocking on the door of our heart. He's showing somebody's face, and we just think it's just something that he's just showing us. But he's showing us because he wants us to pray. All of a sudden, why is it that I start thinking about my teacher when I was in the ninth grade? I haven't thought about a ever since I graduated or when I left the ninth grade. And so all of a sudden, I'm thinking about it every day, come up in my spirit. Remember, then I start looking in my yearbook, and I see my ninth grade teacher. Why is it all of a sudden that I am thinking about this ninth grade teacher? It's because Holy Spirit said that he know that you and I are called to pray. And so it's you that he nudge. It's you that he move upon. Amen. And he will request you to start praying for that ninth grade teacher. Why? Because he want his kingdom to come and his will be done in earth in that person that you keep you're thinking about, that you keep remembering, you know, what happened to you when you was in the ninth grade. He want his will to be done in that person's life. He want kingdom to come in that person's life. Because everything is about the kingdom. Everything is about the kingdom of God. And God want people that don't mind working in the kingdom of God. And so in order for us to be effective intercessors, then we have to be upon the wall. That's a metaphor for us on the wall, being able to see the enemy when he's coming. And so a lot of time we won't be surprised because we're always on the wall. And when they're on the wall, the prophet was always on the wall. The soldier was always on the wall. And they will always walk back and forth and they could see things. And that's what God wants. God wants people that's able to see in prayer, to understand in prayer that we need to be upon the wall. And when we are on the wall, things will not take us by surprise. Nothing will catch us because guess what? We're watchmen. An intercessor is a watchman. They're sensitive to things that need to be prayed for. Amen. And then a lot of times we have to be quiet. Holy Spirit told me my mother was going to pass. And so I told Melvin my mother going to pass within the next 6 months. And she did. Why? Because I was always on the wall. I could always hear and understand him. It didn't matter whether I liked what he said to me. The word is the word is the word. It came from God himself. I believed him when he said it. Why? Because he never came and told me she was going to die before. But I've been on the wall and just praying and praying and praying. Amen. And so when we pray, you know, and I didn't pray for her because he already said it. And so I'm not going to pray for her to live. How do I not know that she didn't ask God to go on and take her? Because she was tired. Amen. And so, you know, a lot of times we have to stand up on the wall. And it's not just to pray, but it's to see afar off. You have to have spiritual insight and eyesight as an intercessor to be able to see by the Spirit of God. You have to be led by the Spirit of God. They see far away. I remember one time I was in Alaska and I was saying, it's been no Amtrak train wreck in a long time. And so I started praying. And the next thing I know, the Amtrak train wreck happened in South Carolina. And I don't think that many people died. You know why? Because I prayed. I prayed. But guess what? It wasn't just me. He probably summoned about seven more people to fill the cup. And so maybe six of those people filled the cup, the reason why the three or four did die. Amen. So one didn't. And so we don't really know. He said we have to stand in the gap. Why is he saying that? Because there's a hole. There's something that's in between these chairs in front of me is a gap. And he called us as intercessors that we're able to bridge the gap. In Isaiah 62, 6 through 7, God has a special intercessor that he himself has strategically set up in a high place to see, to hear, and to understand. And they will not hold their peace, or they will not become silent until God makes Zion of praise in the earth. And so what God is saying is that we are intercessors. And when you are called to intercede, then you will continue to pray and pray and pray until you make God's name, or you, Zion, become a praise in the earth because of what God's doing through you. And then when that person's prayer is answered, what God is doing through them, and then God gets all the glory. And so when we pray, God begins to get all the glory because we're praying for that person. That person get that answer. That person began to give God all the glory. And so everything is about giving God the glory in intercessory prayer. And see, walking on the tower, I call it a watchtower ministry when you're an intercessor. And so walking on the tower reminds us that God has us in position. And so Jerusalem was a walled-in city, and the men walked back and forth, making sure that everything was all right. And the thing is, because God wants a praise in the earth, we as intercessor must walk back and forth, and we began to pray against things that we see that's coming against the church, coming against God's people, something that's coming against this man outside, the one that's cutting the grass, all these different things. Why? Because the thing is to make God a praise in the earth. And so God is calling intercessors that don't mind walking and having that watchtower ministry to just walk and walk and walk. And he wants them to do it willingly. He wants them to do it without grudgingly, amen, being grudgeful for it. And so, and another thing that I like, we have to have a pure heart. Whenever we are intercessors, we must have a pure heart. Because why? Because you want to properly discern. We're not able to, if I'm upset with someone and my heart is not pure toward that person, then if God called me to pray for that person, I just may not pray for them because I got an ought with them. Amen. And so my heart must be pure so I can properly discern the will of God and what God wants to do in my life as an intercessor. When you call to pray, you must develop a God-conscious life. All of us must have a God-conscious life when we are called to pray. You must develop a consciousness that God is going to call you to pray. You on call 24/7. Doesn't matter if you're having your family reunion. Doesn't matter if you're on an airplane. Doesn't matter if you're having your physical exam. If you're at the movies. If you're having family time. When you're called to be an intercessor, you're on call 24/7. Sometimes God will have you to change your plans. Because there's a need. Because guess what? Satan is coming and attacking God's people. And so intercessors are called to a place of confidentiality. When God began to give us something, we have no right to release that information that God has given us about a person. And even with that person, we have to pray to see if God wants us to reveal it to that person. Because when we are in such a hurry to go and reveal something that God showed us in prayer, then we become a hothead because it becomes all about us. And so a lot of times, things are not to be uttered. It's just to be prayed about. And in intercessory prayer, you have to realize that God does not want us to pray amiss. You and I cannot pray amiss. We cannot pray with the wrong motives in our heart. God doesn't want us to pray like that. He wants us to pray with a pure heart. And so I remember when an intercessory prayer, and we would come in here, they would do an intercessory prayer, and they'd be sitting here just talking and talking and talking. And we was like, so y'all finished praying? Well, God didn't have us to pray for 5 minutes. Well, you could have done it at the house. You're wasting your time. Why would you come all the way to a church and you pray 5 minutes if you come in for intercessory prayer? And so what happens, intercessory prayer begins to reveal what's going on with individuals. Amen. We're tired of praying. We just going to sit down. You know, we've been doing this for the last 10 years. Can we take a break today? And so anyway, we have to watch it because our weakness will begin to come through. Amen. And then sometime you do things out of order, stop prophesying to people. You know, unless you have been released to do those things in intercessory prayer, then you should not do those things. Because sometime the word need to be given to the pastor. Well, all the time the word need to be given to the pastor to see it if it's of God. But most of the time people are mature anyway that's doing the intercessory prayer, so they know about all that stuff. But a lot of times when it's a word for the church, now we do want you to give us that word. Now you have to pray about a word, giving it to someone else, because God has to prepare that person's heart. When you pray about a word that God has given you in intercessory prayer for someone, you pray for God to prepare their heart for that word, that whenever he tells you to release that word, they will receive that word with joy and not receive it, you know, grudgingly. And then we have to watch our tone of voice when we give him words. Amen. A lot of times we'll give words and it's so harsh and it's different. You know, God told me one time, he said, I'll show you the worst, but you can prophesy the best. It does not matter what I see. It's going to come out really well. Why? Because I'm a prophet. A prophet prophesies the future. They prophesy. They give them what God gives them for now, for later. Amen. And so the thing is, I don't have to tell them what they're doing that's not right. They already know. So they don't need me to repeat it. Because guess what? That person will go and glorify God. Amen. And so, you know, revealing something to someone, then you have to pray and see if God, especially if it's a strong word, you got to pray and see if God wants to get, you know, to do that word, give that person that word. But a lot of times, this is really funny. A lot of times when someone do something to us, we have hurt in our body. You know, we're hurt over something. And then that person need us to pray for them. And so we really don't want to pray for them because we're like, good for you. You had no business doing it. Now you're in trouble. I'm not going to pray for you. But we have to watch it because guess what? We're concerned about a clean heart. We want to have a clean heart. We don't make the decisions on whom we pray for. God makes the decision. And a lot of times we don't even realize it. When God have us to pray for someone that has done us wrong, could it be that I'm the one that's in the test? Amen. Amen. And so am I going to pray for that person the way that I should pray for that person? And another thing, don't be so caught up if God give you off-the-wall things to pray for. You know, like a man cutting grass, and he got his little four-year-old on the back of the tractor. What you got me praying for that for? Or he's showing you that somebody's looking for their keys, and he wants you to pray for the keys. You know, man, they can find their keys. Amen. And so a child can't find their shoe. Can't find his keys. But if a child is looking for their shoe, or he show you a red car making a right turn, we cannot determine that those are not prayers that God wants us to pray. And so when we get to that point, we can't just wash that off because we just think God's going to always have us to pray for giant things, things that's happening in the government or things that's happening with a senator or a congressman or a person that has a mega church. No, he wants us to pray for any and everything. And he does not want us to come off the wall. Because if you're on the wall, you're on the wall, so you can pray anyway. And God wants us to avert disaster. He wants us to avert disaster. The child on the tractor with the grandfather may fall off. But he have you praying for it because he's showing you what to come. And so he may show you that you avert an accident. Because you praying against the tractor falling over. And that's the same exact way that God wants us to do with one another. when God shows us something, one another, someone in the body of Christ, we are burning things. We're stopping things. Or we're stopping things and keeping them from being as bad as they could be because he summons more than me. And God wants us to not be so concerned about ourselves in prayer, not to be concerned about my husband and my children and all those things. We are intercessors. God will have someone to pick you up in the spirit realm when you're praying for other people. And so the things that you did not even pray for, God will begin to answer those prayers. He said it the other day in 2 Kings 3. He said, whatever you didn't pray for, I'm going to answer. I'm going to give you what you didn't even pray for. Praise God. And so God told us, he said in Luke 22:31-32, he talks about Satan. And we talked about that earlier. His job is to make sure that we don't do what God called us to do. And so that was a warning about the tractor. It's a warning about the keys. It's a warning about the baby can't find his shoe, no matter how minute it sounds. And so Jesus, guess what he did with Peter? He said, Peter, Satan seeks to destroy you, to sift you as wheat. But I, the great intercessor, pray for you that when that does happen, that your faith will not default, that your faith will not fail you. Because guess what? Even though you may, he didn't tell them this, but I'm saying this. Even though you're going to deny me, I still need you to get up and go and heal the sick and raise the dead and all those other things. But I want to let you know, don't let that thing run you over like a tractor trailer. Amen. And so who was the one on, and when they went and started on Antioch, he said, who was the one that got up and started preaching about how they did Jesus? It was Peter. Peter got up. But he was telling him, he said, don't allow things that come against you to default you, to make you not move, because you have to stand. You got to learn from that experience. Everybody, don't nobody want to falter in anything. I don't. But guess what? We have to. At different times of our lives, we have to fall so we can have experience. And guess what? That gives us momentum. It gives us strength. And then when someone else come along and that same thing occurs with them, then we have the momentum, we have the strength that we're able to, the Bible said, when your brother's overtaking a fault, because you're spiritual, because you went through that stuff, you got experience for it, I want you to restore them, because you have the ability to restore them. And there's a watchman anointing. A watchman anointing is able to see way down the road. Jesus was able to see. Even though Peter was walking with him, he has a watchman anointing. He's able to see. He's able to discern. He's able to hear that Satan wants to sift you as wheat. That's a watchman anointing. He walks up and down the wall and seeing all these things that the enemy is trying to do, the demonic assignments against the people of God. We have to be able to listen to God when he nudges us. This one woman, she woke up in the middle of the night and she started praying against a storm out on the sea, on the ocean. And so when she woke up the next morning, she saw that a cruise ship had almost tilted over where the windows were busted and maybe two or three people got hurt. But how many people would have gotten hurt if she had not prayed? Now, it didn't make sense. You showing me a hurricane on the ocean way somewhere in Jamaica? But God is telling you there's a whole ship of people, 5,000 and 6,000 passengers, that could potentially die. But I called for an intercessor, and you came. You woke up, intercessors don't sleep. They don't sleep light. I mean, hard. I mean, you know how it is. They don't sleep hard. Because your spirit is alive to God. The Bible said, reckon yourself to be dead to sin and alive to God. Your spirit is alive to God 24/7 when you're called to pray. And he just nudge you and you wake up and you start praying about things. And then sometimes you may not know when you first wake up what he's having you to pray for, but you're just going to start praying. And then all of a sudden, what he really woke you up to pray for began to float across your mind. You would begin to see, you begin to hear. And see, the thing with that ship, the father, the son, nudged that lady to pray. Sent the Holy Spirit to nudge her. And she woke up. And guess what? The praise of God is in the earth because all those people didn't get killed on that ship. Because of one person waking up. One person deciding to pray like God told them to do. When you're called into praying, you enter a realm. When you really pray, and I'm going to tell you something that's so weird. I just want you to know, everybody go through it. It is so hard to get your mind settled to go into prayer. When you first get down there, you should be thinking all kind of stuff. You be seeing all kind of stuff. And that's fine. But the longer you stay, you're going to start being quiet in your spirit. And you're going to see yourself just moving on out and praying. So there's nothing wrong with you thinking about going to school tomorrow, what you made on your grade today, and all these different things like that. Because guess what? You're going to end up praying anyway, or else you're going to sleep because he gave you sweet sleep. Most people go to sleep anyway. I tell you what, if you say, I just can't sleep, go on and pray. Or read the Bible. You will go to sleep. But those that have a special ability to move into intercessory prayer, they're really drawn into praying all the time. That's a great anointing that God has given them. And some people are called to pray 24/7. Some people are called to pray just here and there. Some people are called to pray for certain things. That's their assignment. My assignment is leaders. My assignment is children. My assignment is the church, and my assignment is marriage. I know what my assignment is with prayer. And so I don't labor all the time praying for those things, prayer. I mean, I don't do that. But when he put something above my hearing and my sight and my mind, then I know. And he will even tell me if this is happening now or this is what the enemy is trying to do in the future. And so you get to learn all these things. He is the teacher. He's going to teach you every single thing about Holy Spirit, about prayer, about your spirit becoming sensitive. Amen. And so those people that are called to intercessory, they just love to pray. They pray, 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 pray. Amen. They pray all the time. And they love to pray. And so because they love to pray, they just get so happy with praying all the time. Isn't this wonderful? We've been doing this for 5 hours. Like, what? It's been that long. But they're so happy about it because they're used to going in the throne room and hearing God all the time. And the thing is, if you have the right set and you have the right music and you go into intercessory prayer, it is bliss. You will be there and you could stay there and it's just so, and he will start taking you places and you will go this place and that place and see this person and that person. Amen. 9 times out of 10, you won't see you. You won't see your family members. You won't see whoever you're married to, but you will see other people. Remember, he will have someone to pick you up in the spirit realm. When you're busy for God, God will take care of you. Amen. Amen. And so there's not a ministry per se in the Bible saying intercessory prayer. But it does come up under help ministry. Yeah. And so whatever we can do to help the church, then guess what? That's a part of help ministry. Intercessory prayer is one of the most hidden ministries in the church, in the body of Christ. But it's the most necessary ministry. And that's why the enemy spends all his time trying to get us not to pray. Because it's necessary for the kingdom of God. It's for us, whenever he tells us to pray, to get up and pray. And when we get up and pray, we will see different things that God will begin to show us and give us. Because guess what? Everything is confidential unless he tells you to release it. And then he will show you the secrets. He will show you secrets. He will show you things to come. Why? Because he can trust you. He'll show you all these different things when you go into intercessory prayer. And you go in there with a clean heart. And guess what? You're serving the people physically, but you're in the spiritual realm. Intercessory prayer is physical and spiritual. The people are seeing us physically moving out in prayer, but spiritually, we're in heavenly places. And we're making war in the heavenlies. The enemy does not like it when you and I pray. The ministry of helps says that there's some, not the ministry of help, but the gifts. The Bible said in the church, they got this, they got that. And then, you know, he said, you know, you got an eye, you got an ear, and all these different things. He said, well, we got some uncomely parts. We got some parts that's not readily presentable. You know, like my nose is readily presentable. You can see my nose. But intercessory prayer, you can't always see it. But it's so necessary for the body to function. And so on the inside of me, I have a gallbladder, a liver, a heart, and all those things. We know about the heart because we're concerned about the heart. But a lot of times, folks don't be concerned about the gallbladder. They don't be concerned about the spleen. Half the time, they don't even know it's there. But it's an uncomely part. The spleen is for immunity. And so the gallbladder releases the bile so you can have brown. And so the thing is, it's necessary. Those things are necessary. Intercessory prayer is that hidden ministry that's necessary. I remember, and I think I told you this story about this lady, and how this lady went, she was at the church for 25 years, and she was in the hospital, and she called for the pastor, and she told the pastor, she said, I'm one of your members, and then he said, well, I haven't seen you. She said, I've been there for 25 years. I was here when I'm just going to say something because I can't remember for sure. When your wife died, I was here, and I was holding you up in prayer, and this and so forth and so on, just different things throughout his life when he first started all the way up to now. And she said, he said, well, you want me to pray for him? I'll come to pray for you. She said, no, I just want to have you to get someone else to take my place. Because she finished the work, and she went on to be with the Lord. But she still was doing intercessory prayer on her deathbed. Glory to God. She still wanted that position to continue. Amen. When she died. Isn't that amazing?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
And so the ministry of helps is any job that you can do to help the church function. And so intercessory prayer helps the church function. In Luke 2 and 37, there was a woman that was 84 years old. She stayed there in the temple night and day. And when they brought Mary, when Mary and Joseph came and they brought Jesus, she started praising God about the baby. She said that this is him, this is the baby, this is the one. But she never stopped praying. She was married for 7 years and her husband passed. And all the other times she just stayed there praying. She did not stop praying. They never said, well, she went home or anything, or maybe her home was there. But what I like, she was able to identify the baby as Jesus. Why? Because she had been in the heavenlies. She had been in heaven. She had been talking to the Lord. One thing that I do know, when you're in intercessory prayer, you get to go to heaven. Hallelujah. You get to go to heaven and you will see the Father and the Son. I remember going to heaven one time and I was just dancing before the Lord. Just dancing and dancing and dancing and dancing. I don't dance in church. But I was there dancing because I had that much joy that he allowed me to be in his presence. Amen. But it only happened through intercessory prayer. She only got that knowledge through intercessory prayer. Guess what happened on Sunday? Exodus 17 happened on Sunday. You had young men that were standing there. And the last young man, he had the rope around his arm. But you had two ministers, male, to go and help hold his arms up. What was that? Intercessory prayer. What did they say that happened with Moses? As long as Moses' arms were up and he was holding up the rod, then Joshua would win the war. But when his arms were getting tired, the men of God saw. This is intercessory prayer. And so if you think intercessory prayer is you just always opening up your mouth, then we done missed it. Because they helped him. They made him strong by holding his arms up. So that rod at that particular time was the rope. That was the authority of God. Because the rod, the string being around their arm, was God's authority having them to surrender. But he was getting tired. And they came and they helped him. And so I don't even have to tell you about Moses, Aaron, and her. Because it happened on Sunday. That was intercession. One thing about it, they got him a stool so he can sit down. They didn't do that on Sunday. But they got him a stool so he can sit down on. And they held him up the entire time. Why? So he can win the battle. So he can win the battle. Why? They didn't want his arms to go down because God was saying, keep them up. He knew what he was doing. He was letting them know, you're going to get tired sometime. But don't you quit. You're going to want to just throw in the towel. Don't you quit. Because I got intercessors that's going to hold you up. And that's exactly what happened. They held him up. Glory to God. Sometimes you'll find an intercessor become reclused. They go into reclusion, and they just kind of be by themselves. It's not a place to stay because, to me, anything done too long become perverted. But they will go into a place, and they will stay, and they will pray and pray and pray until that breakthrough come. They will not leave until that breakthrough come. Amen. That's what they do. And so it does not occur all the time, but it does occur. Guess what happened with Daniel? Daniel was praying. During the time that Daniel was praying, guess what happened to him? See, the thing about prayer, it leads to a lot of things. It leads to dancing. It leads to praising. It leads to agreement. It leads to laughing. It leads to twirling. It does a whole lot of things. Intercessory prayer does that for you. It leads to having a vision. Daniel had a vision. And he had a vision. And in the vision, he saw this man with his face. His face was like lightning, I believe. And his feet were like a brass. His eyes were like flames. And he saw that while he was in prayer. He saw the Lord while he was in prayer. But the thing is, he was in prayer for 3 weeks. He was in prayer for 3 weeks because he wanted to know what that vision meant. So he decided that he was going to continue to pray until God come and answer that prayer. And he stayed there and he prayed and prayed and prayed. And he was weak. And so this man came, which was an angel, which was Gabriel. He came and he said, because you're very precious to God, do you not know the intercessors are very precious to God? Because you're very precious to God. And because you're very precious to God, he's going to give you peace. Because you decide to humble yourself to pray for others that was about to die and no one else did. That's why you're precious to me, because you sacrificed yourself to stay at the altar and continue to pray. You humble yourself before me. So you're precious. He said, but this is what I want you to do. I love this. He said, listen carefully. We can't go in intercessory prayer and don't ever listen. He told Daniel, he said, listen, because if a messenger comes, he has a message. And so the messenger came and he gave him the message. He said, when you first started 21 days ago, I had the answer. But because you stayed on your face and you continued to pray and you did not give up because the answer didn't come right away. Most people, because the answer don't come right away, they want to quit. He stayed on his face because the answer didn't come right away. He kept, I believe he would have stayed there forever until the answer came. And he told him, he said, 21 days ago, when you first prayed, I had the answer and I was on my way. But for 3 whole weeks, the prince of Persia, which is the devil, in his little battalion in the heavenly places, waged a war against me because he did not want those prayers to be answered. He did not want me to get the answer to you. And that's why we have to have patience. Daniel had patience. He always waited on God. He was in the lion's den. He waited on God. You are praying, you have to have patience. We can't pray and get up and say it's going to happen and keep looking for it and then start doubting God. He did not do that. He didn't doubt God not one time. And he fasted and prayed, the Bible said. He was fasting. Amen. We fast not because we're trying to move God. It's because we put in our flesh under subjection. And the other thing y'all try to do is lose weight. That's why we fast. We fast to lose weight and put our flesh under subjection. In the meantime, God coming with an answer. That's what we do. And so for 21 days, he said, I had to fight in the heavenlies. I don't know if you all know it or not, but when we stop praying, the enemy battalion, okay, look at this. These three sections here are the demons and the devils in heavenly places, the powers, the rulers, principalities, that's them fighting. On this side, what Christian is just the saints that's praying every now and then. So guess what? Because it's not 2 men over there praying, it's just 3 of them over there praying. And because those 3 are over there praying, there's not enough people that all the chairs are not filled. So no, it's not enough people over there praying. So all these demons have the up and up. They're the ones that's winning. And so as long as we are not praying, then the demons can keep on moving. But don't let a 4 person come. They'll knock that whole battalion out over there. Now you got 2 left. Amen. 2 left. Because other people have come to pray. And then guess what? If a 5th person come, this battalion is going to be knocked out. If they pray. If they don't pray, and then the thing is, if you get tired of praying, these right here start trying to come back over and join these. Others will come because all of them have the ability to release other little imps. Amen. And then the more we get to pray, the more they'll push back, push back, push back. And that's why Daniel had to stay there for 3 weeks, because he was helping push them back. He was a part of the war. By him standing there praying, he was a part of the war. In the heavenlies, he was fighting in the heavenlies. And he was pushing back battalions of demonic forces, the kingdom of darkness. But if the kingdom of light, which is the people of God, do not pray, then we're going to always feel like we're defeated. And that's why we always feel like we're defeated. Nobody feel like praying. But they'll get up and get that bluebell ice cream in the middle of the night. And I'm going to tell you something. God is whispering to us and said, pray, 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 pray. You You know, he'll go and warn 7, 8, 9, 10 people because he wants the cup to be filled. Because our prayers go up as incense to God. He can smell them. He can smell our prayers. Our prayers go up as incense to God. It is a sweet aroma in his nostrils. But what is he smelling if ain't nobody praying? Amen. And so those demons, they just fight. And so he had to get some help. You know why? Daniel was praying. So Michael, the archangel, came and was fighting the prince of Persia, the demonic forces, because Daniel was still down there praying. Amen. So if we don't pray, don't nothing happen. And then he came and told him the answer. He gave him the answer. Daniel wanted a mistake, but he gave him the answer. And when he gave him the answer, he said, I must go back and help Michael. So even a messenger go and fight. Hallelujah. Because you bring the message don't mean you don't fight. He said, I'm going back to help him. Amen. And he gave him the answer that he was asking for. Praise God. It's happened because prayers went up. Everybody have assignment. Everybody has an assignment to pray for different things. When you pray for the purple chairs and you pray for everybody got an orange shirt and you pray for everybody got on black shoes and you pray for everybody got a red car and you pray for everybody that got to cut the grass, then we got everybody covered. All of us are assigned to pray. So if I'm assigned to pray for marriages and leadership and children, then I'm getting that covered. You may be assigned to pray for the nations. And so you'll call out Africa, and you call out China, you call out Austria, you'll call out Switzerland and England and Finland and all these things. If you're called to the nations to pray. Amen. So you're called up. That's your assignment. And when you're praying that you're praying, you call the nation prayer, you're going to be praying for a minute. Amen. But that's what you're called to do. And, you know, I don't know if you're called to do it 24/7, but you'll know when you're supposed to do it. You'll know when something has happened. There was a leader. And this leader, the Lord just kept bringing him before my face. Kept bringing him before me. And then God showed me what was going to happen to him. So I told the pastor. He wasn't a pastor at that time, but I told him. And it wasn't even 5 months before it did happen. But it could have been worse if I had not prayed for him. Amen. So when he showed me something, I can't say, oh, why is he showing me that? No, get on your knees. Don't get on your knees. You don't have to get on your knees. Get on your knees. Some people get on their knees. It was one woman they showed how she was on her knees. Her knees were so messed up. All swollen up because she was on her knees all the time. Then she went on to be with the Lord, and they saw her pillow was all raggedy because she had spent hours and hours on her knees praying. But the thing is, what was so touching about this is that she had pictures of people that she was praying for, and tears were on their pictures where the pictures were stained because she spent all that time in prayer praying for people. Mother Teresa, when she was overseas and she was praying all the time and she was teaching them what they need to do. And they said, well, Mother, you're sick. You need to go back to the United States. When you go back to the United States so you can get care. You know what she said? I taught them how to live. I'm going to teach them how to die. Hallelujah. That's somebody that's been praying. Hallelujah. And so she was showing them that this is what you do when the Lord is ready to call you home. Praise God. And then there's prophetic intercession. Prophetic intercession, I find myself praying that way all my life. I always been a prophet. But prophetic intercession is when you pray, you worship God. Most folks, they just worship God, and they'll get still, and they listen to God. And I do this. Every time, I do it every Sunday. Every Sunday, I'm just worshiping God every Sunday. For hours, I get up at 2 in the morning, and I worship God. And then I'm still to hear what he say. And sometimes when I'm worshiping him, he's talking to me then. And when he talked to me, Then I start praying. He starts speaking. And so guess what I do? I start thanking him for what he showed me. Because what I say? God shows me the worst, and I pray the best in their lives. And so guess what I'm praying? I'm praying the best in the person's life or whatever. I'm praying that, if I saw a hurricane coming and it hit the back of the church, I'm going to pray differently. Amen. I'm going to pray differently. I'm going to thank God for the hurricane not hitting the church. See, that's what you do. You always thank God. God, I thank you that this young man is healed. God, I thank you that this woman is going to be able to get that red car. God, I thank you that this woman has that five-bedroom house that she's been talking about. God, I thank you that they have food on their table because they were lacking. I thank you that they got a turkey and they can have Thanksgiving even before it comes, God. I thank you. That's how I pray. Sometimes I try to pray. I asked God one time, I said, can I pray like other people? But that's how I pray. Now, I don't know about other people, but I always pray in the future. I always pray the future. I always pray the best. I always pray prophetically because I'm praying the spirit of prophecy, the testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy. I'm prophesying in my prayer for people. You have to become disciplined in your emotions too. When we are in prayer, we have to be disciplined in our emotions. We can't bring what's happening. I know it's so funny. I know a lot of times when people are crying, sometimes it's about what happened or things that they're going through and not necessarily what the service is about. And so our emotions have to be disciplined. Like Pastor always say, whatever you went through before you came to that door, leave it out there. Let's get out. He opened up the door so it can go away. Why? Because it's keeping you in captivity. It's keeping you in bondage that you and I are not able to receive what God has for us. That's the purpose of it's happening. Burdens, bondage. He set the captives free. And so those bondages will come so we cannot hear what God is saying. So we can continue to rehearse it in our mind. One thing pastors say, I don't understand why folks be worried about stuff. Ain't nothing they can do about it. Especially right now. You be sitting here in the church, what you gonna do? And so God is just saying, especially if you praying. Whoa, horse. We have to be disciplined here, what God is saying. Now, am I saying that you can't be emotional? Yeah, you can have joy and all these other things, but I'm talking about things that's going to burden you and I down in prayer when we think about it. Amen. I remember my mama passed. I preached a sermon. They didn't even know she was dead. Folks didn't even know she had passed. You mean to tell me that you preached your mama passed? Yes. What am I going to do about it? I can't do nothing about it. So you have to be able to be disciplined to do the work of the Lord because he already got this thing. He already got everything in control. Another thing having to do with intercessory prayer is that I talked about that about seeing people. But one thing I want to get to, and then I'm going to close, is that when you see Joseph was one that his father really, really cared about him. And so because he cared so much about him, Joseph was the favorite one. And so one day, Joseph, they was out in the field with the brothers, and he went and told his father on them. So guess what they did? The next time they saw him, they decided, we're going to hook you up. So they took his little coat of many colors. And when they took his coat of many colors, guess what God was really doing? Stripping him of himself. That's what he was doing. He was strict because Joseph was an intercessor. You're going to see it at the end when he helped his brothers out. He was interceding for his brothers and his father. But the thing is, God had to do something with him first. God had to strip him. And so symbolically, him having that coat of many colors on and the people that came, the Islamites or whatever they were, they came in a caravan and they stripped his coat. His brother stripped his coat. And then they put him on that caravan. Yep. But guess what was on that caravan? On the caravan was spices for when somebody died. That was symbolic of Joseph getting ready to die to himself. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't it amazing that he stripped him of what made him proud? Because my coat of many colors mean I'm in this many ministry, and I got this going on, I got that going on, and look at me. Look at me, I'm Joseph. I'm the favorite. Look at me. And so all those colors were symbolic of the different ministries, you know, that we are in. And God have to snatch that stuff off of us and strip us so we can have a perfect death, burial, and later on resurrection. Praise God. But the thing is, when he went, they end up putting him in jail because he went to Potiphar's house, and they end up put him in jail. And so when he was in jail, he told a man, he said, you know what? I think the cup bearer ended up having to be in the cup bearer ended up having to be in jail. And so he was talking to Joseph. And Joseph was telling him how to get out of there. And he ended up getting out of there because of a dream. Joseph interpreted the dream. And so Joseph told him, he said, now, don't forget about me when you leave out of here. Because I interpret the dream. I'm just saying all this. I interpret the dream. And because I interpret the dream, that means I'm the man. All those pronouns that he was using, if you go and read, you will see in Genesis 39, 40, and 41. The thing is that he was concerned about himself. But he never edified God. So guess what God did? So you still got that pride, huh? You still got pride in you, huh? I let you go to jail. Strip you of your coat. Even had stuff ready for your burial, death, and resurrection, death, burial, resurrection. And you still are cocky. Still talking about yourself. He was arrogant. That's right. That was the word. That's why I got written on my paper. And so anyway, guess what? The man forgot about him. He forgot to tell the king about him. So there was another dream. And see, he didn't glorify God. He was on talking about himself because he was the man. And that's something that we have to watch in intercessory prayer. It's not about us. It's about the people of God. It's about them, and we're there to pray for them. Remember, other folks are going to pray for us. So therefore, God wants us to get our business together and pray for other people. Amen. So Joseph, the man remembered Joseph because King had another dream. And so Joseph interpreted that dream. But guess what he said? No, he didn't interpret it right away. But this is what he said when he came the second time. He said, oh, I can't interpret it, but the Lord can. Yeah, see, he just needed to be stripped a little bit more, 2 more years. He stayed 2 more years in jail. The first time he didn't glorify God, he glorified himself. Amen. 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 And he still, I think right after that, I'm not sure. Yeah, right after that. No, before that, he was talking. This is how he went to jail. He was talking about with him and the woman. And he was saying, you don't know who I am. He was telling his wife, you know, I'm the number one person in this kingdom. You know, I'm close to where the king is. He elevated me. You know, that was when his wife was coming after him, when Potiphar's wife was coming after Joseph. He said, do you know who I am? I'm next to the king. I'm in charge of all these people. See all these pronouns? That's why God had to take him, pull him down a notch. And then when he pulled him down, he learned. And after that, he ended up going to become the number one seed in the kingdom. God restored him. Amen. And so in intercessory prayer, we have to remember that we are there to stand in the gap. They have to have someone to walk across. You have to bridge the gap. There's a big hole between them and God. And God will do things through you, his ambassador in the earth, through intercessory prayer, through way of Holy Spirit. And you will know to bridge the gap for people. Because he said, I wish no man would perish. That's why God got intercessors in the body of Christ. That's why he got intercessors all around the world. His number one thing, I wish no man would perish. And how can they not perish? How can they not perish when they're sick? How can they not perish when they need food? How can they not perish when the enemies come against their mind? How can they not perish when they don't have a car? How can they not perish when they don't have money to go to school? How can they not perish when they're looking for a job? Through you and me. They will not perish because God summons you and I to minister to him so that he can send the answer. So they can cause him to be a praise in the earth. Amen? Let's give God a hand praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen.